My presentation is on the concept of super cities. And for doing that, I would like to explain that the research done on super cities, and we call Territorial Diamond, we did from Fundación Metrópoli, which is an international center of innovation in cities and region. We began 25 years ago at the University of Pennsylvania with a project on cities we call Proyecto Cities. And we analyze, we study these 20 cities in collaboration with 20 universities. This is today the EcoBox, which is the building of the Fundación Metrópoli in Madrid. And I would like to highlight that our foundation has an alliance of collaboration with UN Habitat and also with World Tourism Organization for the practical implementation of sustainable development goals. Today, many institutions, many cities agree on the objectives of the sustainable development goals, but the practical implementation is another issue. So we are working with these two organizations for the practical implementation of the sustainable development goals. Initially, I wanted to share with you that we live in a world of cities. Never in the history of the humanity, cities are transforming at the rhythm of today. But I would like to say that middle-sized cities will have a bigger role, will have a new protagonism in the urban system today. This reference can help us to understand the future role of medium-sized cities, particularly after the pandemic. In less than 20 years, you see, medium-sized cities will go from representing 11% of the GDP of the world to represent 37% of the GDP of the world. When I say medium-sized cities, it's a big spectrum between 150,000 inhabitants and 5 million. So we don't consider mega cities and no rural regions. But these cities, particularly those around main cities of the world urban system, are developing an important role. The key problem for medium-sized cities to be relevant in a global economy is the lack of critical mass. So the only possibility for medium-sized cities to be relevant is to collaborate one with other cities, creating urban system, creating we call territorial diamonds. This is the first research we did together with the University of Pennsylvania on the territorial diamond. You see, for instance, the Northeast between Philadelphia and Boston. So these are the new engines of the global economy, no cities in isolation. This group of cities, these territorial diamonds, will be very relevant in the future. And we apply this research for specific projects in different regions. For instance, this is Colombia. This is Colombia. And in this area, in this triangle, with approximately 14 million people, we call the Caribbean Diamond, we did a project with the different cities in the area, in the different governors of the different departments. And this project is called the Caribbean and Santander's Diamond of Colombia. That allows us to understand the role and the complementarity of different cities. Instead of competitive advantage, we are looking for complementary advantages, discovering the different profiles of different cities through this isochrome, this functionality, and at the same time, eco-development strategies. So in nature, so particularly the Magdalena River, the coastal line, are the backbone of the project, and at the same time, the functionality, not only the administrative division, but the functionality of different cities leading the territorial diamond. If we go to Chile, you see in Santiago de Chile, these are isochrome of 30 minutes. Chile, Santiago de Chile, Valparaíso, San Antonio, 30 minutes, 45 minutes. So you see different characters, complementary character. You see Santiago and the mountains. You see Valparaíso and the port. You see the rural areas in the middle. So these new entities, this territorial diamond, in the case of Chile, in only this diamond is 56% of the population of Chile. And this is the main engine of the Chile economy. We apply similar research in Europe, and we discover this European diagonal: Lisbon, Madrid, Barcelona, Marseille, Milan, and we call the European diagonal. This collaboration and complementary profile of cities can inspire infrastructure and can inspire a new way of thinking beyond traditional administrative boundaries. In this context, on a smaller scale, you see, for instance, Bilbao. The transformation of Bilbao only can be understood in the context of the urban system. You see, Bilbao and the cities around, Vitoria, Donostia, Santander, through a project we call the high-speed train in the Basque Country, Y-Vasca, we call, we try to reduce the time distance between the different cities to create a bigger economic space. So this new functional area will give the cities of the Basque Country, Bilbao, San Sebastian, and Vitoria, a new representation and a new collaboration. So the transformation of Bilbao only can be understood in the context of this complementarity of medium-sized cities creating territorial dynamic. Even if you see between Europe and Asia, Istanbul is a beautiful city, but Istanbul go beyond Istanbul. In this particular case, we have 21% of the population of Turkey around the Marmara Diamond, but almost 40% of the Turkey GDP. But for instance, Bursa is growing 10 times faster than Istanbul. So understanding these new territorial entities will help us to define the future infrastructure: roads, high-speed train, ports, and connectivity. And even if we go to Asia, again, the same thing is happening. This is Singapore. This is the latest project, Marina Bay Sand in Singapore, very well-known project in Singapore. Singapore is a small island. It's an island of 750 square kilometers. Some 40 kilometers is west, north-south only 25 kilometers. It's a very, very small country with 6 million people approximately. And we did a project called One North, how to attract talent to an island like Singapore. One North is a project on 200 hectares, and you see the urbanism of the project in relation with the functionalist urbanism in the surrounding. So this experience of One North, a place to attract talent, a place to live, work, play, and learn, was very relevant. Every color represents a different use, not only at the scale of the urbanism, but also at the scale of the architecture. So you see different uses that will allow people of different profile to work together and to accelerate innovation and creativity. This is the parametric design of One North, and is mainly inspired in traditional European historical center. This is Vitoria in the Basque Country on the left, and this is One North. So public space for exchange of ideas. Traditionally, in the old technology parks, the connection between people working in different corporations is not easy. So in the case of One North, that was one priority, one objective. Today, this project is almost finished. We have 50,000 high-tech jobs working in One North, and that has been a reference in Singapore. Today, Singapore created a company, Ascendat, to replicate One North in other countries. But Singapore is becoming a living lab, a laboratory of experimentation of urban solution. The port, the airport, social housing, congestion charge, every project in Singapore is conceived to attract talent, to create a prototype, and then to export the solution. But Singapore is going beyond Singapore. You see, Singapore in 1900, 1950, 1990, and you will see now in two decades the enormous growth of Singapore, but it's growing beyond Singapore. We call Singapore Super City. Singapore Super City is a city in three countries: Malaysia on the north and the islands of Indonesia in the south. In this context, you see on the left, on the right here, Bintan, Bintan Island. We designed this island, this eco island, to be the future growth of Singapore. And this is the project I wanted to share with you briefly, which is the Bintan project. You see this area in yellow, this is Indonesia. The per capita income in Indonesia is 10 times less than in Singapore. So imagine the potentiality of this island, Bintan, on the right, which is more or less 40 minutes by boat from Singapore to be really relevant. So in order to define an eco island, we analyze the coastal line. Coastal line is very important for the island. And in Indonesia, we have 18,000 islands. So it is important to understand the idiosyncrasy and particularly the small villages, how we can maintain the character of the island by maintaining these fishing villages, and also how we can understand the ecology of the island, and particularly the natural profile of the coastal lines. So we design nature, we design a second nature as a reference for designing the island, maintaining the forest, the fauna, and also the water system. This is the main capturing area of the water, catchment area, you see, and through a dam, we would like to use the technology used in Singapore in Marina Barrage to create this freshwater bay instead of seawater bay. And this freshwater bay is the excuse for the development of these eco communities around the bay. So in the road, instead of having a bridge, we will have a dam. And this is a way of connecting the water system with the future feeding of the fresh water to the population and also for the agriculture. So around this nature understanding, we are proposing the road system, and this is the eco island design for the whole Bintan. Bintan will be in close connection to Singapore to grow and to design, and this is something unique. As an island, technology and digital technology is very important, and mainly for the diversification of the economy. The diversification of the economy is really very, very, very important. Finally, I would like to highlight one example of singular projects in ASEAN area, particularly in Hanoi. In Hanoi, we have the Red River Delta, territorial diamond. So this is Hanoi. Hanoi is in the center. And this is the a light intensity map from satellite. And again, we identify not only metropolitan Hanoi, but also medium-sized cities around Hanoi that can be a reference to the creation of a territorial diamond. And this is in 1 hour and 1 hour and a half isochron with 30 million people in this area. This is the territorial diamond of the Red River Delta. Important to understand the ecology of the area, which is really spectacular, and also the industrial development. These are industrial parks. Vietnam has been very successful in attracting industrial sites, in industrial parks. And I would like to show you EcoPark. EcoPark is an innovation center for giving advanced services to these industrial parks and industrial zone. And EcoPark, we inspire in nature. We are designing with nature. You see the water system and also the pedestrian spaces. We design the soft part of the project and then the architecture. And for the architecture, for the creation of an innovation center in Vietnam, we have the digital village. Digital village, we are experimenting with a new scale of blocks. We call the living blocks. So the living blocks is not only eco-architecture, bioclimatic architecture, but also mixed use. Mixed use is very important, and emphasizing peripheral pedestrian boulevards and waterfronts, and then all the services can be provided from inside. This is totally the opposite of the super block in Barcelona, for instance. No? And also another typology, the Global Corporation Campus. So we try to combine the typology of the high-rise building with the concept of the podium. The podium defines the public space. And the architecture can be bioclimatic, can be mixed use, but we try to combine public space defined by the podium and freedom of shape and image for different corporations in this global corporation campus. Also, we are experimenting zone that we call phase zero for connecting with universities, for residents, co-living, co-working, faculty club, and so on. And even some areas like Vietnam Town. The Vietnam Town is inspired in traditional architecture, but with contemporary design. But the dialogue with nature for us is really key. So this is the Diamond City. This is the hub of innovation in metropolitan Hanoi. And the idea is to have a mixed use, as you see in this image. And also this physical design could be combined with digital design. For urban mobility, you have the fiber optic ring here. For autonomous vehicle and also for electrical charging station, smart solution. And also the different buildings, both facades and roofs, can be the element for the capturing of energy. Very important to understand the combination of different scale, from the scale of the diamond, the scale of the super city, and the scale of innovation district or specific projects to be developed. Through a participatory process, we identify as a priority this hybrid urbanism, design with nature, livable places 24/7, places for innovation and attraction of talent. Through our participatory process with local leaders and local representatives of different constituencies, we identify this reference for the design. And in terms of branding, we have stone here, stone, and this is a diamond. So diamond is a man-made jewel. So we call the Diamond City because it's in the heart of the territorial diamond. So thank you very much for your presentation, and I will be happy to make some comments on your reactions.
Thank you very much, Alfonso, for your more than impressive presentation and giving us such a global view of developments going on. Are there any questions here in the auditorium? Yes, please.
Yes, okay. Good morning. Thank you, Alfonso. My name is Nir. I come from the Technion Israel Institute of Technology. I wanted to ask you regarding the last project that we've seen, Diamond City. You've mentioned a term called hybrid cities. I wanted to ask, what in your mind is the difference between hybrid cities and mixed-use cities? Where is the demarcating line between hybrid cities and mixed-use cities? Thank you.
Oh, thank you. We call when we say hybrid city, in this particular case of Eco Park, we are in a traditional rural area, so it's hybrid between rural and urban areas, being in the context of this polycentric structure where you combine nature with functionality, and of course mixed use. So mixed use, a place to live, work, play, learn, for us is very important, particularly for innovation centers. Going from traditional zoning to a places of interaction and innovation. So the problem is how to manage to attract these different users and to create the chemistry for innovation. It's not easy. Singapore, we have been working with more than 20 years with Singapore, particularly in One North, to create this ecosystem of innovation. It's not easy. And particularly when private developers, they are specialized in housing or specialized in office building or in commercial spaces, or they are providing technology solutions. So it's not easy to have the leadership for creating these innovation hubs. So, but with the term hybrid, we are trying to express hybrid typologies, dialogue between nature and physical space, between digital and physical. So this is the how we try to use the concept of hybrid for our projects in urbanism.
Thank you, Alfonso. There's Pietro.
Pietro Elisei, thank you for this great presentation. Alfonso was really impressive. I have a question, maybe two questions. I mean, when you were presenting the concept of super city, I was thinking back to other models. I mean, the growth poles of the 50s or the regional city of 70s, 80s, Stadtregionen. Which is the difference of the super city? And when we look at very important parameters with the old models, we see that cities are not in balance with the ecological footprint, the impact they have in relation with the surrounding territory. Could be the super city a level of action where we can put again in balance the cities with their surrounding territories, in a way, could be an opportunity for better planning for climate change?
Thank you. Wow, this is a very good question. For us, super cities, the name of my book on super cities come from a philosophy a movement in Oxford University. They are working on the concept of superintelligence. And they consider superintelligence the combination between human intelligence and artificial intelligence. So artificial intelligence, particularly connected with digital technology, is promoting smart cities. Smart cities is mainly how technology can help to have more efficient cities, so for water, for transportation, for saving energy in the building. So smart solutions are very important. Artificial intelligence and technology can help a lot the city to improve as smart cities. But there is something more important, in my opinion, that smart solution, which is the human intelligence. Human intelligence is leadership, is having a vision, is ethic, is commitment, is a community that understand and is able to share a common vision of the future of the city. So when we combine human intelligence and artificial intelligence, we have super intelligence, and we call super cities to cities that is generated with this super intelligence, super cities. Super cities is not the reference to mega cities. Mega cities is about the size of the city, but super cities, you can have a super city which is a medium-sized cities or a mega city region. No, but so our concept of super cities is these new entities, in some cases polycentric. When are entirely polycentric, we call diamond, territorial diamond. But this is the concept we want to express when we say super cities.
Thank you, Alfonso. I think we have two more questions now. Yeah, please, short questions and short answers. We have to come to an end.
Dear Alfonso, this is Rudy Kaufmann from Germany. Thank you for a very interesting presentation. Relating to the Bintan project, you said that it is a challenge to strike a balance between keeping the traditional characteristics, or I would call it the identity of the eco-island, and technical improvements. Would you say that the identity is normative for the technological developments? And would you say that citizens have a right to decide on how this identity of the island might change in this development?
Good. The experience of Bintan, you know, is the project is led by the Ministry of Planning of Indonesia. And we did an experiment of designing one island with these concepts. They have, as I told you before, they have 18,000 islands in Indonesia. We did an experiment. In the case of Bintan, they have two local entities, kind of two mayors mainly, and then there is a governor of the small archipelago, Riau archipelago, and then they have the central government. They have a lot of problems of governance and no tradition of participation in the area. All the planning, all the design of cities provided by Fundación Metrópoli are mainly based on participation. Even we have a we call channel of institutional participation, which is a mechanism very agile to integrate different sensitivities in planning the future. That was an example led by, in this particular case, led by the government of Indonesia. They invited the different institutions, but unfortunately, in this case, we were not able, by the for the structure of the local leadership, to have a direct access to the citizens to understand better the how they feel their own identity. There was a kind of soft agreement of collaboration between Singapore and Indonesia to create one island that can use the strength and the growth of Singapore and giving some complementarity activities. For instance, today the talent cannot go anymore to Singapore, it's too expensive. If you are a Singapore citizen, you have access to social housing at a very reasonable and affordable price. But if you are expatriate, you are working for an international company and you want to rent an apartment, is very, very expensive. So it's not easy to have talented people. Young people are not the rich people in the society to work in Singapore. So we are creating new communities to live very close to Singapore, because Singapore attracted 18,000 companies over the last 30 years. And they need to grow, but they will grow outside outside Singapore. So it's not easy to prepare an island. Bintan is a little bigger than Singapore, to prepare an island that can be in complementarity with Singapore for functions that are needed in Singapore and the government of Indonesia want to develop. But in this particular case, unfortunately, we were not able to develop our traditional participatory process directly with citizens, only with representatives of different stakeholders of the society, private sector, public and civil society organization.
Thank you, Alfonso. A very last question. Please, Frank.
Yes, hello, Alfonso, Frank, don't Isocarp. Well, this afternoon I will try to showcase the Eurodelta as a potential case of a super city in Northwest Europe. But my question, learning from that example, is always territorial governance, because it exists. I mean, people are using it already, but the governance has not followed the evolution. Now, you as a planner and designer, Alfonso, do you also advise your clients on changing the territorial governance in such super cities?
This is a very good question. In my opinion, one of the most difficult points to deal with is the lack of correspondence between the administrative division and the functional division. So in my opinion, understanding the ecology of the territory and the functionality should be the base for the delimitation of super cities and territorial diamond. And this is not easy, because we do think that diamonds are becoming engines of the global economy, and super cities are being relevant elements for the development of the countries and regions. But the problem is the political fragmentation that do not allow this cooperation. In some cases, has been created some agencies. For instance, in the case of Bilbao, they created Bilbao RIA 2000 to help different institutions working together in a particular area. But usually it's not easy to find that. In the case of the diamond in Colombia, the client was the Development Bank of Colombia, called FINDETER. And FINDETER, because belong to the government, has very good dialogue with the governors. So the dialogue between mayors and governors for thinking together in the future of Caribbean Diamond of Colombia was very, very positive. But in the future, they were not able to create a new entity, a new territorial entity at the scale of these functional areas. It's very difficult. But sometimes it's not necessary, because sometimes you can share a vision of the future and you can identify strategic projects. And each project you can push, you can develop in collaboration with the local entities that are responsible for that. But the global perception is key. This way of having a vision of the future of this territory in a participatory way, and then to be able to not to define and planning everything, but to define strategic project for the transformation. And this specific project will have specific stakeholders to participate.
Thank you very much. Well, presentation by Alfonso Vergara, impressive as always, I would say. Thank you very much, Alfonso.